Hey guys, welcome back to Q&A Monday, where I try to answer the most common questions I get in my life coaching practice around happiness, love, and really connecting to your most authentic self. So today's question, which I get all the time, is what does it really mean to practice self-care, right? I think there's a huge industry now around personal development and self-care, and you always see things being sold and telling you if you buy this crystal or wear this bracelet or use this coconut oil, that means that you're practicing self-care. And I think there's a little bit of truth to each and every one of those, and certainly those are aspects of it. But, you know, I have clients all the time who come to me and say, I've read all these self-help books, I work out or I try to get to the gym at least twice a week, I even booked a vacation for myself next month, and yet I still don't really genuinely feel cared for. I really don't. And so what does it mean to care for myself? How can I feel like something's not missing? How do I feel like I have the care that I need right here? Well, I totally agree with that assessment of self-care, that sometimes the way in which it's sold to us can be kind of lacking. And so I want to share with you today my definition of self-care, which is super simple, extremely practical, and really actionable, which if you watch any of my videos, you'll realize that's my style, giving you concrete action steps to really build healthy habits, behaviors, and thoughts, right? So today, I want to share with you that for me, self-care basically means treating yourself like you would treat your own three-year-old child. Now, I know that seems overly simplistic to some of you, or maybe a little out of reach to some of you, because not all of you have children, and definitely not a three-year-old child necessarily, but just hold on for a second. Imagine, go through this experience of pretending that you have your three-year-old kid, your first child, they're 3 years old, boy or girl, whatever you want, and you think that this is the most precious person in the world, right? Which is what most parents think about their children, right? So imagine that you have this child around you, or maybe for some of you, you don't need to imagine that you actually do have this child. Now think about, generally, how you treat this child, right? Think about how you would decide on the activities that they're going to do throughout the day. How would you decide how they spend their day? Based on what other people think they should be doing, or based on what really makes that kid happy? How would you decide what kind of physical environment to provide for them? How would you decide what kind of people to surround them with? How would you decide what kind of food to give them? What kind of sleep and how much sleep you would let them have, right? Most importantly, how would you talk to them when you're upset or when you're happy? How would you do all these things for them? All right, so if you've given that some thought, my guess is that you came up with answers kind of like this, right? So perhaps you said, okay, I would definitely let this child spend most of their day doing things that make them happy, right? And definitely not let them spend 8 to 10 hours of their day doing something that they don't like with their lives, that they don't enjoy, right? Which is what many adults do in their job. I definitely will give them ample amounts of sleep so that they're well rested and their body can heal. I'm going to give them the food that's nutritious and delicious so they enjoy the experience of eating. I'm going to surround them with people who are kind to them, who are good to them, who really care about them inside and out. I'm going to let them make friends with the people they want to be friends with, the people they want to connect with, right? I'm going to do all of these things for them, and most importantly, when I get upset with them, I'm going to chat with them and I'm going to explain to them through love and kindness and patiently what's going on, why I'm upset, and what they can do to make the situation better, how they can learn, how they can grow from this experience, right? And you would do this all with patience and with kindness, all coming from a place of deep love for this child. Thought about that for a second? Okay. Well, now let's go back to the definition of self-love. Self-love is treating yourself the exact way you would treat your own three-year-old child. Okay, so you're looking at, think about for a second how you typically practice self-care and how you practice care for this child. I bet the whole paradigm shift, right? It's gone from being, okay, I care about, I'm going to do one thing here and there. I'm going to do an activity whenever I find a moment. Two, I'm going to set up my lifestyle in a way. I'm going to design my routine in a certain way. I'm going to talk to myself consistently in certain ways, right? And so that's a big shift from being one more thing on your to-do list to being how you design your entire life. That's the major shift that you have to make when it comes to self-care, to making self-care feel more like a way of being than something you're doing. Right? All right. So let's talk about a little bit what this means practically in terms of some activities that you can do to start to mend the difference from one to the other. So one of my clients this week was doing a reflection on exactly this, that she was thinking about, okay, how do I treat my 30-year-old nephew and how do I treat myself? And the biggest discrepancy she came up with was that when her 3-year-old nephew is upset, she brings him his favorite teddy bear. She brings him his things that are going to comfort him. She sits with him. She says, I understand your pain. And she gives him a hug, right? And eventually, she doesn't judge whether it's rational sadness or irrational sadness. She just sits with him and allows that feeling to be there and comforts him and supports him while he's there. Meanwhile, with herself, she tries to run from her sadness. Why am I sad? I shouldn't be feeling this way. I can't believe I'm letting little things get to me again. Why can't I just focus on the good? What's wrong with me? Okay, fine. Let me just go get some ice cream and comfort myself, right? Totally different approaches to showing up for someone when they're sad. And so in the spirit of connecting those two things, I want to give you an activity that you can do so you can comfort yourself in the same way as you would a 3-year-old child when you're feeling sad. So I made a little activity, and it's called the Caring Blanket Worksheet. You can download it from the link below. I'll post it right after this Facebook Live finishes. And so what I want you to do is download this activity, and you can see here that there's all different little holes. This is a blanket, and there's all different spaces in the blanket. Now, why do I have a blanket here? Well, you remember my client said that when her nephew gets upset, she goes and she brings him a teddy bear. Well, we all had some kind of teddy bear or security blanket when we were a kid that made us feel really comfortable, right? That comforted us when we were sad. Maybe it was a stuffed animal. Maybe it was a place in your fort that you would go and run. But either way, you had some source of comfort that really just made you feel better, made you feel attended to, comforted and cared for when you were little. And so we're going to create your adult style blanket, your security blanket. And don't quit on me here. I know a lot of people are saying, oh, as adults, we shouldn't need a security blanket. We should not have to be vulnerable. Well, you know what? That's not true. While this life is beautiful with tons of gifts and tons of presents and so many things for us in this life, it is also challenging at times. We have breakups, we lose our jobs, we lose people we love. We have all these things happening, not to mention you could walk out of your apartment and have a bird poop on your head, right? So it's really sometimes life can be challenging and we need a blanket to wrap ourselves up in and feel comforted and feel kindness and cared for, right? So I want you to take this and take the next 5 to 10 minutes or so after this is over and just begin to reflect on experiences of being comforted or being cared for. So the first thing that you're going to do is think about times in your life. I'm going to tell you about different kinds of ways of feeling comforted and cared for, and I'll guide you through different things so that you can fill this out. So the first one, as I said, is feeling included. All right, so think about a group or an organization or a community in which you are included. You just feel like you're one of a pack, like you really can belong there. Okay, think about that sense. And I want you to write in one of these boxes, anyone that you choose, one experience where you've had that. You can write the experience, you can write the name of the group, you can draw a picture of it, whatever it is that resonates with you, in any box, write that. And then take another second to, once you finish that one, write in another box other places where you felt included. Really try to fill out as many boxes as possible with experiences of feeling included. Okay? Then what I want you to do is think about experiences of feeling seen. So feeling seen is another version of being comforted or cared for. Okay? So think about that time when somebody just understood your needs. You didn't even have to say anything and you were just understood. They took care of you. They showed up for you. Feelings of being seen. And again, I want you to take a few minutes and write down in different boxes all the experiences where you felt seen. Okay? All right, now on to our third kind of feeling cared for or comforted is feeling respected. Think about the times where people were showing gratitude to you for something. Maybe they were complimenting a skill or a talent or just a way in which you show up in the world. Some way in which you felt that you had a positive impact on the world and people were really showing that to you and appreciating you. So respect, appreciation, think about all the instances where you felt that and write them or draw them here in a box or in many boxes. And then lastly, the feeling of being liked or loved, right? And again, this can be by your pet, it can be by a tree, it can be by your partner, anybody, but somebody who you feel just really enjoys your company, just feels like you are a wonderful person to have around. Write down those experiences. Okay? So now you have, hopefully, all of these boxes filled out where all of these experiences of being comforted, cared for, all of those beautiful sensations that we all need to feel, especially when we're sad. So the next time that you're sad, I want you to take this out, and I want you to read through these experiences of being comforted and cared for. Close your eyes and soak in how beautiful it was to experience those things, to go through those feelings and those experiences. Recognize just how many incidences in your life are of care and comfort. And wrap those feelings around you like a warm, comforting blanket, the way you would if you were. I want you, every time you have an episode where you're feeling sad, to show up and show yourself self-care in this beautiful way, which you deserve, which kids deserve, which we all need throughout our life. So I hope this was helpful, and I really, really hope it changes the way you show care to yourself throughout your days. Let me know if you have any questions. Feel free to post them below, and I'll see you next week.